Hello, everybody. Welcome to our April 26th Franklin Municipal Planning Commission meeting. Appreciate everybody being here. We will start our meeting with the review of our minutes from the March meeting. Is there a motion?
Move for approval.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. All right, ladies and gentlemen, this is an opportunity, if you're here to speak to the Planning Commission on items that are not on tonight's agenda, we have this in the meeting for you to come up and present your thoughts. This is not on the agenda, so if there's anybody that wants to speak for non-agenda items or not on the agenda items, please let me know. All right, seeing none, then we'll move on. Catherine, any announcements for tonight?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I would like to ask that we start a goal-setting session with the Plan Commission. I believe that Chairman Hathaway wants us to do that, and what we will be doing as staff is setting out some possible times, trying to get an idea of when everybody can have a separate meeting. Our conceptual workshops are way too crowded to be able to do a really good job of goal-setting at those. So we want to look at some times that you might be able to take a time, 2 hours or thereabouts, and get started on some goals for this commission going forward.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Catherine. Just to add to that, what I want us to do is think about some of the things that we get so busy looking at individual items from applicants and such. We don't stand back and think about what are things that we as a commission need to either advocate for or such.
Is that a tornado sign?
Tornado sign. Okay. All right. All right. Then we will adjourn the meeting until further notice.
Where we go?
I don't know where we go.
Okay. That's better. We might go ahead and leave.
Neighbor, we'll all kind of go together. All right, we have this moment for any non-agenda items. If you want to present something that's not on tonight's agenda, please let us know that. All right, I see none, then let's move on to the consent agenda. We have two consent agendas. We have our initial, which is more general, and then we have our secondary, which are more specific. Folks that need to recuse themselves. We'll start with the initial consent agenda. Commissioners, you have these on your list. We also need to add items 45 and 47. The applicant would like to defer. That'll be a one-month deferral, I believe, to next month's meeting. So I'm going to include that as part of the initial consent agenda. So it's items 45 and 47 that would be deferral.
And do you want to say what that is for the, for anybody who might
be here? Yes, let me get that out. Keep thinking there's a vacuum cleaner going or something. These two items are relative to the Amelia Park project over on Clovercroft. For those in the audience that wanted to speak to this item, these are being deferred till next month's meeting. Items 45 and 47 will be deferred as part of this consent vote. All right, is there anything on the consent agenda that staff or commissions wants to pull from the agenda? All right, I see none. Then is there a motion for approval of the initial consent agenda?
Move for approval with staff's recommendations.
Okay.
Second.
Second. Moved and seconded. Discussion? All right, seeing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. All right, I have an item on the secondary consent that I'm going to recuse myself from, so I will turn it over to Roger to handle the secondary consent agenda, please.
I also have an item on the secondary consent and will not be voting on this item.
I do also.
We're good? Okay. Okay, the secondary consent agenda consists of items number 36, 43, 55, 57, and 59. There's not a call to remove, to pull anything from that, so is there a motion for approval of the secondary consent agenda?
Move for approval.
A second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
All right, thank you, Roger. To my list here. So I believe that puts us at item 44, if I'm counting right. That would be ordinance 2012-21, to be entitled ordinance to rezone plus or minus 15.81 acres from General Commercial District GC to Civic and Institutional District CI for the property located at 124 Lumber Drive. Staff?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This request is to rezone the recently acquired city property, formerly the 84 Lumber, from General Commercial to Civic and Institutional. It's pretty straightforward. All city-owned properties are zoned CI, and this would also be the same thing with this request, too.
All right, thank you. Is there anyone in the audience that would like to speak to this item, other than the applicant? The applicant's sitting in front of me. All right, seeing none. Is there a motion on the floor?
Move for approval.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? All right, seeing none, say, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Item number 46, resolution 2012-23, a resolution approving a development plan for Alexander Plaza PUD subdivision located at the northwest corner of Murfreesboro Road and North Royal Oaks Boulevard by the city of Franklin, Tennessee.
Mr. Chairman, staff recommends approval with revised conditions. Condition number one regarding the design modification has been revised to recommend approval for, of the reduction from 75% brickstone or precast concrete, scored precast concrete, to 55%, and all facades facing arterials with the exception of the existing facade that faces Royal Oaks Boulevard. And that one would, staff recommends to keep that one the same as it is currently. The existing facade has 14% brickstone or scored precast.
Okay, all right, thank you. Anyone in the audience, other than the applicant, would like to speak to this item? All right, seeing none, is there someone representing the applicant?
Good evening. My name's Jason Morlock with Perry Engineering. Also have Bruce Dallinger and Bobby Capers, Kroger, Spirit Glass, and three questions we want to have. We agree with all staff comments regarding condition four. I've spoken with staff prior to the meeting. We'll continue to work with staff regarding the design of the door that we would like to put along the front side. Very responsive and outdoor seasonal merchandise area. And what we're intending to do is items that would typically be sold outside of the store, bring that back into the store, and just open the overhead doors during periods of warmer weather and close them otherwise, but it will help clean up the front of the store and make for a better, cleaner front side. I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have.
All right, thank you. Is there a motion?
Move for approval.
Second.
Moved and seconded, any discussion? All right, seeing none, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you. Item 58, Spring Creek Subdivision Site Plan Revision 6, lots 8 and 9, 268,099 non-residential square feet, and an increase of 4,600 square feet from approved site plan, and 13.87 acres retail shops revision located at the southeast corner of West McEwen Drive and Mallory Lane.
Mr. Chairman, staff recommends approval with revised conditions on this site plan. Condition number eight regarding the shared parking study has been removed with this revision. The shared parking study shows a maximum peak demand of 602 parking spaces for all of the uses proposed on the site. The 690 proposed spaces should be able to accommodate the demand based on the applicant's calculations in this parking study. The zoning ordinance would require 819 spaces if each use was calculated separately, but together on the site, since they have different peak times, they are able to submit this shared parking study, and staff has found that since there's only a 16% internal capture rate, staff would favorably recommend this shared parking scheme for this site.
Okay, thank you.
Also, sorry, Mr. Chairman. Condition number nine has been moved from a condition of approval to a project consideration.
That's relative to the stormwater management?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Is there anyone in the audience who wants to speak to this item other than the applicant? Is there someone representing the applicant here?
I'm Mark Spalding with Gresham Smith and Partners. I've also got Mark Cole with Drury Development Corporation here to answer any questions you might have.
Okay, all right. So you're in agreement with staff conditions?
Yes, sir.
Okay, is there a motion?
Move for approval.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
Due to professional conflict, I must recuse this item.
Okay, thank you. All right, any other discussion? Seeing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you.
All right, item number 60, ordinance 2012-05, to be entitled ordinance to establish section 2.4.11 and amend section 5.6.4 of the Franklin zoning ordinance, which establishes requirements for fences and walls.
Mr. Chairman, basically what this zoning text amendment does is add to the already existing chain link fence allowance from front yards and add to that the allowance for decorative metal fences. The idea being that both the metal fence and the chain link fence have enough opacity that people can see through them and they don't block side streets, that type of thing. So that is one of the components of it, is just adding the metal fence to the chain link fence. The other component is the provision for permitting and permitting of fences throughout the city and certain stipulations and requirements regarding that permit process. That permit process will be done by Building and Neighborhood Services, and anybody having a fence of 6 feet and above would be required to get a permit. Those of 8 feet and above would be required to have engineering drawings.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Anyone in the audience other than the applicant want to speak to this item? All right. I see none. Then is there a motion?
Move for approval.
Is there a second?
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion?
Question.
Yes.
I need to make sure I clarified. I just understood you to say that any fence over 6 feet would require a permit, correct?
That is, yes.
Okay. So a 5-foot fence would not require?
That is my understanding, is that a 5-foot fence would not require a permit, but.
Okay, and maybe I'm just reading this wrong, because it says.
Yes, at over.
It's over 6 feet.
Over 6 feet. Okay, well, wait a minute.
Permit shall not be required. A permit shall not be required for fences under 3.5 feet.
3.5, that's what I'm looking at, 3.5 feet.
Yes, it's 3.5 feet. Anything beyond that would require a permit. Anything but 6 feet is generally the maximum allowed in residential districts.
So if I wanted to put up a fence that was 4 feet tall, I would have to get a permit.
That is correct.
How much would that permit cost me?
That we have not decided. That is not part of this zoning amendment.
Well, I'm going to tell you now, I got a problem with this. You already knew it before you probably came before me. I really do. Okay. On a just someone who just owns a home and wants to put a fence up, keep the neighbor's dog from coming over and doing his business and all of that. I think it's a little bit intrusive to require that homeowner who's going to have to pay what, I don't know what fence runs in that, $1,200, to come down and get a permit from the city of Franklin that says it's okay for you to put a fence up. you know, it's okay for you to put this fence up. So what happens in the permitting process? You can come out and tell me if it looks good, if it doesn't look good, what color it should be. So I need some understanding here on this. I really do.
There are some requirements around fences and the type of fences that can be put up and how they're put up. At the current time, what is happening is no permits are required, and then either we get a complaint or Building and Neighborhood Services notices that they're not put up correctly, and then we the city have an issue in trying to get them into compliance that could have been taken care of prior to that had a permit been taken out and an inspection done on that fence once it has been installed. Additionally, it's a safety issue. You know, we would have as part of that permitting process an installation an installation inspection where an inspector could go out and make sure that that fence was installed appropriately and safely.
So now if my fence is not installed correctly and you come and trip over and break your neck, I'm liable, right? I mean, I'm liable, correct? That's because it's on my property. So we have enough resources in the city of Franklin to pay people to come out and inspect fences and all that. I'll just stop there. You know where I'm coming on this. I think we're getting a little bit, you know, it was the same as when they brought the thing up that said you couldn't have a fence in the front yard, okay? Well, my same objections for that stand for this, and I'll just leave it there. There's no sense in going on.
Now, is this applies only to non-residential?
It applies to residential and non-residential.
And non-residential.
Okay. Any other comments? All right, seeing none, then.
There's a question.
Yeah, you mind coming up front, please?
I'm Alderman Dev Berger, Ward 1, City of Franklin. I hate to see the city do one more regulation. I'm with you, Marcia, but and I'm very concerned about regulating the fences like that, but we have had some issues in my ward where they've had fences, even within HOAs, put up along the alleyways that have been on the right-of-ways, and they've gone right to the curb. Here would be the curb. You're supposed to set it back, I believe, 3 feet, 4 feet. I'm not sure how many feet, but you're supposed to set it back, and a lot of people have been putting the fences, and the fence companies have been coming in, putting them right along the curb. And when people try to get out of their driveways, they can't see. You can't see till your car is out so far so that you can actually look up and down the alleys. And we've had issues with the children running out or being by there or very close to the roadway or the alleyways. And so I think a lot of that has been brought up because of those issues. Now, there's probably sensibility in some of that because people are not obeying or watching our right-of-ways, and neither are the fence companies. So that's an issue y'all should discuss because I don't know how that's become an issue, and that's become a problem in some subdivisions and even outside some subdivisions. So you might want to chit-chat about that and talk about it because that is one of the issues I think they're trying to address here. But again, I just hate putting more regulations and having somebody have to come in and get an approval for a 4-foot fence. We've had another issue in one of the neighborhoods where someone put up a fence and it extended out. If you've got your home here and here's the back wall of your home, here's the corner of the house, they've taken it from the back and the house faces this way. The house over here faces this road. And they've extended that fence out beyond the edge of the house, out further. So when these people over here are backing out of their driveway, they're having a hard time seeing down the street. So there are some issues going on there. I just wanted to let you know about them. Thank you.
Thank you. I guess the interesting consideration here is that to avoid that, we could have had a permit, but they could have installed it wrong, and who would have followed up to make sure it was installed correctly?
Well, that's, you have HOA, it's ACRs to regulate
so
that.
Currently, you've got, like you said, HOA, you've got complaint, the vehicle to complain, and you know, hopefully get it corrected if there are guidelines, which I know there's guidelines in place that give you the ability to say it's in the wrong spot.
Well, that's so what I was going to say. Aren't there already, for what Alderman Berger was addressing, there's already something that should be able to, you should be able to say, this is in the right of it, move it. I mean, so I understand what you're saying, but to me, this is overkill. If you already have something that'll take care of that situation, why are we,
because now what you do, in my opinion, we're putting an extra burden on somebody. I'm just telling you, I'm speaking as someone who has a piece of property I need to fence in. Well, I'll be. It's tough enough to pay to get the fence put up, okay? Then I got to come down here and get a permit and pay for it. And I just think we're just taking a shotgun to kill a gnat here. I just think there are other ways to do this. I don't support it. It's just one more thing. And one more, then you can have enough people to inspect them. And then are you going to inspect them every 10 years after that? Because then it could be unsafe. What if I let my fence become run? I just see this as a snowball, and it's going to get, it could get bigger and bigger. What Alderman Berger was speaking of is the issue, we already have things in place to take care of that.
Let me say, I think that we probably do, I mean, we should have something, and I'm sure we do, about the right-of-way, but I believe this adds, one of the things that this adds is a requirement that there be a certain line of sight. Yes, and I don't think that is in, mm-hmm. I don't think that is currently required. Mm-hmm. But I do agree that the right-of-way, you know, that if they're in the right-of-way, that certainly is illegal right now.
I understand. I just think there will be some unintended consequences
and there may be.
From this.
You may be right about that.
Mr. So
where did the 3.5 feet come in? Why 3.5?
Three and a half, I have no idea why the 3.5, but it is pretty common in the International Building Code. The 3.5 is the point where there really isn't any structural integrity you need to worry about. After 3.5, you're really talking about not only structural integrity, but you're talking about a visual aesthetic that really becomes part of why we would look to have these fences permitted.
I'd like to say that we do have restrictions on fences in most neighborhoods. There's a lot of homeowners that like to abuse that covenant, and it's an ongoing issue. You can tighten it up all you can, but you're still going to have some issues. I think the 5-foot aluminum black fence is probably the most appropriate for these newer neighborhoods. It's the classiest look. Your corner lots, we have sight distance, side entry garages off of Corner Street. A lot of people would like to take that fence all the way to the curb, but we restrict that as well to within 25 feet of it, or 20 feet. And then even at that, you have a lot of homeowners that'll ask for fences with corner columns that are not in character with the neighborhood, where your regular rectangular lots are built without the corner. So, you know, going forward, I see an issue with the fence requirement. Because you've got pre-existing fences out there now that are over 3.5 foot tall. You have them in the front yard, you have them in the side yard. So I think there just needs to be some clarification. Maybe I'd like to ask for a deferment and a little more information on it.
Wait, if that's a motion, then we need to get a second on that.
Give me time.
I'm sorry.
It has been asked to defer this amendment. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
The second, I second.
Okay. Vernon, did you want to speak before we vote on the motion to defer?
If I may, because I know I was, first of all, the storm has moved through Central Franklin and is heading east, so hopefully everybody will be safe and has been safe while that storm rolled through. And appreciate everybody staying in the building here. What I wanted to say briefly, and when the issue about requiring a permit for something, I would only ask that you consider our employees here that will receive a call from a resident and visit a property. And it's not about a permit just for a fence, it's just some of the things that we don't have permits for, where many communities do, and then we're asked to enforce regulations. And one of the reasons that we renamed the codes department to Building and Neighborhood Services is because that's what we want to do. We want to provide information. We want to help people maintain their neighborhoods, which in turn talks about maintaining our community and quality of life. And it's a very precarious, uncomfortable position for our employees to go out after somebody has invested in a fence and say, you didn't comply with our regulations. You should have checked. And it's not just fences, there's some other things, but this was an opportunity to bring this issue before you. Because I know many of you, the aldermen, get those calls, well, codes did that. I mean, it's a defensive, non-helpful connotation. We want to help grow this community, and you've got a great number of employees that want to do that. And having contractors who put up the majority of fences obtain a permit, which they'll be able to do online very shortly, isn't a lot to ask. And even residents that want to do it, to obtain those regulations and do it in accordance with our expectations as a community. Thank you.
Okay.
All right, question.
Yes.
So do we envision this costing $100, $20, $15? Because, guys, that makes a difference, too. It's just one more thing that you have to pay for. Just one more thing, you know, along with your three property taxes. It's just one more thing.
Well, and it may be 5 feet is the number instead of 3.5. 3.5 is not adequate in a lot of cases, the height.
Yeah.
So I just think it ought to be studied a little bit more. And I'm for Vernon and the staff, obviously, for what they're trying to do. The neighborhood services, I think that's a great idea. And
I mean, is it?
I'd like to see some examples, you know, maybe. And
is it even possible to have a permit process without a cost?
I would just ask that you keep in mind that it will cost the city money, and it does cost the city funds to go out and to do the inspections on fences and to, you know, to make sure that those fences are in compliance with the zoning and the building codes. It already costs funds. Probably any fence permit is not going to cover what it would cost to do that, but
right.
There has to be somewhat of an offset.
Does that address the PUD encroachment where the fence will cross over PUD right away? And Brentwood, we can't put the fence over the PUD, so we have to set the fence in 15 feet off the side yard.
This would allow us the opportunity to review for that, and that's another somewhere, I can't remember the exact reference in this ordinance, but that somewhere it mentions that there's a brief mention about obstruction of stormwater flow, and that's one of the other issues we run into regularly, is that particularly when there's like a swale or a ditch in the back of lots that back up to each other, you know, there'll be between a 10 and 20 foot easement back there, and oftentimes homeowners are going and they're building those privacy fences right on the center line of the swale. And then when the person behind them comes to build, you know, they mm-hmm. they may put it 3 feet back, they may put it 5 feet back, you know, there's a lot of variation there. And what happens when it, particularly when it rains hard, you know, those swales are supposed to convey water, mm-hmm. so we've taken, you know, a swale mm-hmm. that was supposed to be this big to carry this much water, and all of a sudden we've restricted it. And if you think about that, it's like sticking your thumb over the end of a hose. Mm-hmm. So what happens when you do that? The water goes a lot faster, so then you get erosion problems. And that's when we start to get a lot of the complaints. And, you know, our building and neighborhood services staff, streets, engineering, we have to go out and look at a lot of these things and try and come up with ways to fix problems where oftentimes it comes down to, well, the city can either spend maintenance money to, you know, put new grass and do turf reinforcement because the water's moving faster, or we tell those homeowners that they have to tear their fences out and move them back, you know, 10 feet to the edge of the easement. And that's frustrating for a homeowner because, you know, hey, I went and just paid, you know, all this money for this privacy fence. I didn't understand that easement line was back there, and the whole back of my fence is there now, and now I got to move that in 10 feet. So having a permit process like this would allow us to talk to that homeowner and say, hey, you really need to put there a risk that we'll tear it down. If we have to come through, there's a drainage problem on the back end.
And I hate to beat a dead horse, but you know what? If you put a fence up, it behooves you to put it on your property. That's common sense to me. You can't legislate for ignorance. I mean, let's be honest. I mean, if that was the case, we'd have legislation for walking in the middle of the street when, you know, getting hit by a truck. I understand what you're saying. I'm not saying that. Just understand what I'm saying. If you put your fence up on my property, you're going to have to tear it down. You should. If you put your fence up 10 feet beyond your property line, and I hate it, you should have, even me, I should have to tear it down and move. So I'm just saying, guys, I understand what you're saying, and it is so valid. But we're going to require the rest of the city, and maybe some folks who can't even afford a privacy fence, to pay for the for folks putting up a fence somewhere else. I'm just saying, I don't like this. I think we can get so, boy, we can legislate for a whole lot of things. And every one of the examples given tonight, if someone had found where the property line was, it would have been alleviated. Maybe not the site, but I'll shut it.
All right, the motion is for deferral. Is there any other comments about the motion to defer? All right, all in favor of deferral, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Michael is the one vote no. Motion passes. All right. Item 61. This is ordinance 2012-7, a map amendment to revise the development standard overlays of the City of Franklin zoning map.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Basically, we have several zoning maps. This one addresses the character area overlays and the development standards that apply. And basically, the development standards primarily deal with the setbacks. So we have two different setback standards in the zoning ordinance. What we've done here, you're going to notice the boundaries are different. We've updated the Seward Hall character area, the Barry's Chapel character area, and probably a little over 2 years ago, the Central Franklin character area. It's bringing those boundaries that are within the land use plan in accordance with the zoning map. So that's the boundary portion. We've also changed some areas. You'll notice there are a few areas on the map that were marked conventional that are either now possibly, and there might be one that's swapped. Staff looked at those and logically said, you know, in some places it makes sense to have either standard apply and not necessarily traditional setbacks. So it adds some flexibility there. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer it.
Okay, thank you. Anyone in the audience who wants to speak to this item? All right, seeing none, is there a motion?
Okay. Move for approval.
Is there a second?
And
the discussion, Mr. Peterson.
I just had a question. What's that one blue traditional still left down kind of south?
Is it towards the bottom of the map?
Yeah.
It's the Berry's Berry Farms Reams Fleming Track. Their pattern book sets the setbacks and traditional fits within that.
I thought it must be something like that, but I didn't take the time to go look at it. Thank you.
Sure.
Okay. Any other discussion? Seeing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Item number 62, ordinance 2012-08, to be entitled ordinance to amend chapter 3, section 3.5, subsections 4, 6, and 10 of the Franklin zoning ordinance, which establishes regulations for character area overlay districts and the special areas therein.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This text amendment is related to the map amendment. It's updating the text for the character area overlays to match the approved land use plan amendments. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. We've made every provision in conformance. There's some differences that the policy side in the land use plan may be more vague. So if there's questions, those regulations may not be exactly implemented in that zoning text amendment. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
All right, thank you. You want to end up for anyone in the audience who wants to speak to this item? All right, seeing none, is there a motion?
Move for approval.
Second.
Y'all almost were exactly at the same time on that one. It's like stereo on both ends. 3D Planning Commission. All right, there is a proper motion and second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Is there a motion for deferral? Defer this meeting. Is there a motion for adjournment? So we are adjourned. Thank you.